crossing the Nile on the way to Abydos. Oh, look up here and a look over this way.
As we get to the other end of the bridge crossing the Nile, a police unit sort of joins onto us and escorts us pretty much the rest of the way. Now, one unit sort of went and then it stopped, another one started. I counted four different units on the way to the Abydos temple. The Egyptian government doesn't want any trouble there because it's bad press and they'll get less tourists. On another occasion, I noticed two tourist cyclists riding along the road, and indeed they had a police escort with them as they made their way towards Luxor.
Ahead of us here, we now have a police escort on the way to Abydos that we picked up at the bridge. We've been travelling now with the police escort here, and the man is certainly armed for about 10 minutes, quarter of an hour or so as we make our journey. And they're ahead of us for general safety, I understand. On the road to Abydos, we go through many checks. The police check us sort of over and over again, just taking note of the number plate and taking note that, in my case, I'm from Australia. This is our fourth police escort on the way to Abydos.
Yes.
Welcome to Abydos, even though we've already been through the town.
The temple is very large and complex.
Okay, Abydos, at the temple here, you can see the circular region there. There's one over here as well, and the sections here where the large stones, this one turns a corner, the large stones have been it surely assists them to stay together. So the main temple is up this way.
Either side of the main causeway in the forecourt leading up to the temple, you have the absolution wells there. And these would have, if you will, holy water in them, or they would have in the day. And of course, they would have been much more elaborate. So the initiates, if you will, would purify themselves with water as they head further into the temple. And of course, this may remind one of the holy water within Christianity, within certain practices also. And of course, Christianity would dovetail with what is happening in Egypt. Now, I was in Old Delhi, and there is a temple there, the Gurudwara Sis Ganj Sahib temple, a Sikh temple. And I did it, and other initiates sort of going in there, not that I'm an initiate, but going into that temple, you would purify yourself in a way with the water heading into that temple also. Now, just to note that when we get into the temple, that there will be the etheric water, I would suggest, symbolized within the temple. But we'll get to that. Just backtracking a bit, it was a bit nerve-wracking taking the footage of the police. Now, the facade at Abydos, the main facade, had a lot of sort of reworking to it, so I kind of bypassed that and went into the temple, and we'll have a look at some footage within the temple. But just to say that with the barge, we'll see the barge there, or the bark, the boat. Just to say that this
I would suggest is actually an interdimensional kind of creation, if you will, strange portal-like piece of what I really do think is an interdimensional piece of symbolism rather than of course an actual barge.
The solar bark up here and the figure here with the energies flung to the staff as they do across here also. The participant here with the energies going up and over the further entity. The stone is offset with that central tree going through. Here in the temple with the bark and the two figures kind of floating up, but you have
the goddess Hathor in this case emerging from the lotus. Now with the boats just in general, I would suggest they're actually interdimensional. They're not practical boats in many of the cases depicted. So you have the boat, but you could think of it in a way as three, or in a way as a kind of magic circle also. But so you have the lotus in the center, but you have the kind of lotuses, the portals, not only in the center, but at the outside also. So you can see animals emerging or goddesses emerging, etc., from these portals. And indeed with the animals, there's the association with the animal and the boat also, like the ark of the Bible. And you have the architecture upon the boat also. The architecture in the center of this kind of interdimensional creation, if you will.
Within the temple, the various barks, and with this one up here, interestingly, from the portal, you have the digit pillars coming out.
It's really interesting up here within the temple in Abydos, among many other features, with the pillar being held up here and the eagle, Horus-like or Sukhu. There are a few gods that have that eagle type head within Egypt, but so also you just have the scale between the figures, of course. But once again, the pillar with the emergence of the figure at the top of the pillar. So here within the temple in Abydos, there's certainly much to see. Much of it just escapes the sort of reality of the physical, with the sort of emanations coming from the hands. But beyond that, and just to look out, this is looking out of the temple through there, but within here, among many depictions, is this fantastic depiction up here. And among other aspects, you have the central pillar, and importantly from the central pillar, as you will often see, right in here you have the griffin-like winged lions, and the working of the pillar, particularly by the two main participants there, which is just so famous throughout the world, but depicted in so many different ways, alchemical ways, with the main pillar sort of emanating upwards like so. So within this temple further, there's some really important, in my mind, imagery. For example, here you have that little staff in the hand that goes across from the hand. And indeed, this portion in center shot would be a hand also with the kind of flame fire pointing out.
and in this case the other hand seems to be assisting it, and then we have the further ritual situation here. But turning around, first of all down here you have the participant on the throne, and from the hand again you get a really good look. So the participant here is holding the staff, and the fire is kind of emanating out in this case. And it would certainly look like that. You have the flail, staffs and crooks right there, but among other aspects, so in this case fire in one hand, and there's a pitcher here with what looks to be water in the other. So a really kind of blatant fire and water. And there's a pitcher here with what looks to be water in the other. So a really kind of blatant fire and water energies into the center in this case, and in this case coming from the left hand for the fire and the right hand for the water in this case. Now, stepping back and looking up further, there's an absolute classic up here. And so you have the bark, the barge, and then you have the end of it as a portal way in itself, with another lotus in this case kind of coming out of the portal. And indeed the same would apply here, and in this case with the figure kind of emanating out also.
So now that we've seen a bit of bark boat imagery in Egypt, you can look to India, and within this design here you can see the mage in the center, and you can kind of see it's swastika like but beyond that you have the boat aspect to it as well, if you sort of take the opposite ends of the boat and divide it into two, if you will. Indeed, within you have the mage in the center, in this case meditating, but you have the second layer there, and you have the four boats outside of that also, if you look carefully. And that design you can see further in India, you can also see it in Egypt and elsewhere throughout the ancient world. In this depiction from India, you can see the two fish there, which of course would relate to Pisces in this case. And at the outer edges, you can see the four entities holding up the ritual, what I would suggest is a wider ritual situation here. And indeed, in Dendera, Egypt, you can see that same configuration with the picture of the zodiac there. Now, the boat itself, the vessel, here you can see it between the two pillars and associated with the ladder, Jacob's ladder, I would certainly suggest. And in this case, you can see it kind of behind the veil as well. And I would suggest that veil, in a way, is the veil of the physicality, the physical lock that most of us sort of find ourselves in. And we can't get ourselves, our mind, beyond that. So the bark or barge, as it's kind of termed in Egypt, the boat, is certainly, I would suggest, linked with the central pillar. It's like here is an obelisk, for example, in Newtown, Sydney, with a boat sort of emanating out. It's also integral with the tree of life, so to speak. So here, in a way, it's sort of coming out of the pillar in a way. And here you see it, or in these shots, you can see it associated with the foliage rather than the water in this case.
Okay, so within the temple here in Abydos, we have many, many interesting depictions with, you know, also variant skin colours and just so forth, and what would, to me, appear to be ritual situations with variant colours, perhaps relating to the elements. In this case, the necklace type configuration, but held in the hands, possibly a kind of a portal way, in a way, very similar to what you can sort of see around the neck also, perhaps relates to the chakras in a very esoteric way. Yes, it's all very strange, but you can see the... water, or the etheric water emanating from the mouth. That's the bark.
So you see the emanation from the mouth there, and that may remind one of a gargoyle. Now, of course, the gargoyle would have the water flowing out, the physical water, but I would suggest it's etheric water. Actually, this is an interdimensional scene, but sort of re-depicted. I've already mentioned that the barge or boat, I've mentioned about the sort of structure in the center, the architecture in the center of the boat, the central pillar in a way too. Now with the boat, this is sort of one means of an interdimensional kind of structure, if you will. And the other main one is the chariot also. So there is this interconnection between all of them. We will now proceed kind of out the back of the temple at Abydos to the Assyrian, and out there will be the Flower of Life and some other aspects.
The main temple is up here, and just down this is Assyrian, this place here. The blocks are just massive. Within here, it's the blocks are just massive, and it goes into the water. And just zooming in here, this is these are the famous Flower of Life depictions within the rock here.
Access right down near the Flower of Life depictions wasn't available, but nonetheless I got these shots. I could pick out at least five different ones there. Now they do look a bit out of place, but nonetheless, very interesting. And of course the blocks there were just huge. Now at the Ajanta Caves in India, I came across that Flower of Life also. Others have come across it, but I came across it myself. And it's at the third eye level, or the crown chakra level, the higher chakras there. And I certainly suspect that when you're up through the chakras, it's sort of part of the teaching, part of the awareness, part of the background to the universe, the geometry to the universe. Hence, within the Bible, there's mention of the fish, the 153 fish, tying the Vesica Pisces in, the great architect of the Bible wielding the plumb bowl, much just the same as Freemasonry with the great architect and all the rest of it. So this sort of etheric background geometry sort of binding the universe in a way, binding everything from the larger cosmos to the smaller cosmos, this geometric numeric background to things. Within the Bible, they make a big deal about the net not being torn. Of course, the Bible is a very complicated alchemical text.
Just for a bit of a look here at Abydos, within the work down here, there's a huge katush, but so this is kind of under the desert. You can't go in here. It's not public, but it's below the sand, basically, with the Horus and Osiris right over here, and just picking out the four elements. The four elements, those would be part of what's depicted here, and then just coming around. Great scene. And just another look at the blocks over here. And these huge megaliths through here. So the main temple is just up through here, here at Abydos. Up within the relief here in Abydos is Nephthys. And just interesting that Nephthys is holding the kind of two or three rods in one hand here, and that holding them right there, and that down here you see the two birds right there, and you can see these two around the figure also, kind of making the edifice around the figure also. Up here is an excellent depiction of, and I'll just draw in closer, the caduceus-like serpent making, sort of snaking its way up the lotus. And you can see the serpent there. There are two of them, so there's another one just tracking that down in the other hand within the depiction here.
So we're just leaving the Abydos temple. We were waiting for a police escort. Now we seem to be moving, so we've got police escort, yeah? We've got a police escort, eh? So the police escort is right behind, and we are making our way out away from the Abydos temple. There's a truck here with a whole lot of corn on it. Why are the police doing that? Is that to get them out of the road? Ask them to move far out. So we want to get around this truck. The police are not happy that we're hanging around here. Been heading out about 10 minutes, 15 minutes. The other police dropped off, and now there are some more police up front. We're back to crossing the Nile, just starting here. And this is where the police escorted us from to the temple at Abydos this morning. We're now crossing back over the Nile. It was the Nile to the temple at Abydos, that run and on the way there, the police escorted us the whole way, and they partially escorted us on the way back with a couple of different teams of police, vehicles of police.